sins, and make us worthy to announce your resurrection with the angels, to proclaim it with your women disciples, and to rejoice in it with your pure apostles. We raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
You are witnesses, and so is God. how devoutly and justly and blamelessly we have behaved toward you believers. As you know, we treated each of you as a father treats his children, exhorting and encouraging you, and insist that you conduct yourselves as worthy of the God who calls you into his kingdom and glory. And for this reason, we too give thanks to God unceasingly, that in receiving the word of God from hearing us, you received not a human word, but as it truly is, the word of God, which is now at work in you who believe. Praise be to God always.
And living with her, no grief, but rather joy and gladness.
thinking thus within myself and reflecting in my heart that there is immortality in kinship with wisdom, and good pleasure in her friendship, and unfailing riches in the works of her hands. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This text that I've just read is not from the liturgy today, but from the Book of Wisdom from the Old Testament. At some point I encourage you, if you don't read any other book in the Old Testament, read the Book of Wisdom. It is one of the most poetic and most beautiful descriptions of wisdom. And, as we would say in the Syriac tradition, a type of the announcement of the coming incarnation of the Divine Word. This reading is actually taken from this morning's office suffering on wisdom. And what this section of the text of wisdom is doing is anthropomorphizing wisdom, personalizing it, and coming to realize that in her divine beauty, she is not only attractive, something that I would desire to possess, to be wise, to have the ability to foresee. Not only is she attractive, but as it says in the text, that there is immortality in kinship with wisdom. That wisdom itself has a way of bringing light, it illuminates a situation, and it gives us, ultimately, eternal life. Now we bring this up because we have this very short gospel today of Martha and Mary. Very simple, very short, and it's recorded only in the Gospel of St. Luke. None of the other gospels record this domestic scene. It is in the context of just before this episode is our Lord's teaching of the parable of the Good Samaritan, which you all know certainly very well. Then we have our Lord passing through the towns and arriving in Bethany. It doesn't give us the name here, but we know from the other Gospels that Martha and Mary live in a town called Bethany. It's a couple miles outside of Jerusalem. It's a little village. Then we have this domestic dinner episode today. And then immediately following this, at the beginning of chapter 11 of St. Luke, our Lord teaches his disciples the Our Father. So why wisdom and this context? This gospel is in a certain way the summation of the last 2 weeks that we have considered. With the healing of the Canaanite woman 2 weeks ago, we saw the manner in which grace comes into our lives. Healing takes place, but that the grace is always marked by both the resurrection and by Calvary. Last week, of course, we had the parable of the sower of the seed. And there we considered the fact that in reception of the seed, it was dependent upon the soil, how we receive the Word of God, how we receive wisdom. And we mentioned that the ground that actually brought forth 100-fold, as opposed to the trodden down field, the pathway, and to the stones and the brambles and the thorns, that ground has to be broken up and manured, fertilized. And that is part of the receptivity. And so here we see the context of our Lord giving the parable of the Good Samaritan, that his disciples have to be disposed not only to desire good, like the attraction towards wisdom, but to accomplish the good to the degree that it is given to us to do so. To be disposed to always be, as it were, the Good Samaritan. This is not easy to do. We can all admire helping people. We can all sit and watch television and admire those who are on their boats down in Houston, bringing people off of the roofs of their homes. But to be part of those people who left Maine to go down to help, that's a different question. To actually do is much more difficult, obviously, than just simply to desire. And we live our lives filled with good intentions. Always hearing in the modern world, well, she meant well. He didn't mean to do that. Well, ultimately, what our Lord and the Good Samaritan is telling us is, it's our actions, the fruit of what we do, is that by which ultimately we are judged, because it indicates what's within. In English, we don't have the words directly of that kind of foo-foo, that nice idea of doing something good but not doing it. From the Latin word, the French have taken the word, we do have it in English, you've probably never heard it, it does exist. It's called velleity. Velle in Latin means to will. But velleitas means it has the quality of wishing. In other words, it's an inefficacious desire. We all desire good for humanity. We would all love to have world peace, and yet within our family, I have that second cousin or that sister-in-law with whom I have not spoken to for 10 years. So it's that velleity, the inefficacious desire. What wisdom does is move us forward into that parable of doing good, beneficence, and not simply benevolence. And then, of course, in the teaching of the Our Father, following immediately this episode, our Lord is giving us the priority of things in existence, that God Himself be honored and recognized as origin, that your name be sanctified, hallowed be thy name, that not only that God be honored, but that the divine intent and creation and beauty be not only something which is accomplished among the spiritual realm of the watchers, as we call them in the Syriac tradition, of this vigilance of these beings of fire around the divine throne, but that that divine beauty and order be accomplished also on earth as it is in heaven. We engage ourselves in the Our Father, and we ourselves become that translucent conduit that we talked about last week of Lebo Shafio, of the luminous heart. And so the Church has given us then to consider the episode of Martha and Mary. The story is very simple. Our Lord arrives at the home of Bethany, and they're going to have dinner. Martha is running around, getting everything done. We all know that scene. Mary is just simply, as it were, sitting in the living room on the ground next to our Lord, listening to everything that the divine word has to say. And Martha's frustrated. She's frustrated because there's a lot of things to do, and my sister is sitting on her duff in the living room. Martha's not considering the fact that Mary is listening to the Messiah. Martha knows this reality of this great man who is in her home. But she's blinded by the things around her. And so when she comes in, she's not seeing the Messiah teaching her blood sister. She's seeing the fact that I have dishes everywhere and there's things I have to get done. Lord, don't you see this? There's a rebuke in her question. How can you be letting her sit here while you know I have things to do in the kitchen? It's one of those very wonderfully intimate ways of rebuking someone without saying that directly. We all know this within families. And so she says to him, Lord, don't you see that I have many things to do? Ask my sister to come and help me. And our Lord gives this wonderful response, that Mary has chosen the better part. He says to Martha, you are worried about many things. He doesn't say those things are bad. She's not doing anything wrong. It's just not good enough. It is not wisdom practice. And we'll come back to that in a moment. But he tells her that you are concerned about many things, but there is one thing necessary. And Mary has chosen the better part. And this shall not be taken away from her. The story ends. Now, we can probably assume that Mary got up to help her sister in the kitchen after all of that. But our Lord uses it for a vital moment of teaching. And it connects with this Lebo Shafio, the luminous heart. What is wisdom in the Christian tradition is that we come to see all things transparently. That Martha's problem is not that she's doing things which are good. What she's doing is well and it's fine.
But she blocks on it. She stops at the level of the surface. She does not see through them to see that the Messiah and the Word incarnate is in her home. Not directly. She acknowledges it as a velleity. She knows that it's, she calls him Lord. And yet, it doesn't change the way she's judging, which is why we know is inefficacious. We have to come to the point where what wisdom is that we see in this luminosity of the Shafyutho in the Syriac tradition, is that we not only that we receive light into the good soil and that it brings forth fruit, as we mentioned last week, but that we ourselves in that divine light are not only conductors of the divine light, but that we begin to see things as being transparent. In other words, behind the events and the things in our lives, we see God at work. When we do this, even when there is drama in our lives and difficulties and even great pain, we ultimately see the providence that we claim we believe in God the Creator. But that transparency, that lightness, that Shafyutho can only come with wisdom. Which is why the prophet in writing the Book of Wisdom saying that in reflecting upon these things, he came to understand that kinship, being in sync with divine wisdom, brought immortality. And so this Martha and Mary episode, St. Gregory, way back in the 6th century, already gave us the interpretation between Martha and Mary as being the classic images of the active life of Martha and the contemplative, the more prayerful life of Mary. Both of them are part of Christianity, but our Lord makes it clear which is superior. So that is a practical point for us to finish with, that it is precisely in our morning prayers and in our evening prayer, we take a few minutes each day to frame our day. We used to stop for the Angelus, morning, noon, and night, for another few moments to consider the Incarnation, so that our entire day, what we're doing by these prayers, is not that we get something out of it, but that we are beginning to correspond with the grace which God is giving us, transforming the way we see and entering into the path of wisdom and the Shafyutho, and creating in the collaboration with grace the label Shafyutho. This is not something which is done overnight. But if we wait until we are 130 to start putting it in action, we know that it will be too late. And we will die unprepared. And so this path of wisdom, that while one doing good and the prayer life both have their place, as our Lord told St. Arthur, you are concerned about many things, but there is one thing necessary. Enter into the light, pursue wisdom, seek to develop in collaboration with grace the label Shafyutho, and as your sister has chosen the better part, it shall not be taken away from you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Oh,
continue with the anaphora of the 12 apostles on page 754. 754.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Merciful and holy Lord and Father, through your only begotten Son, you have prepared this spiritual banquet for us. Accept the offering of this bloodless sacrifice and grant us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and divine love, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of the Holy Spirit.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing for the Lord.
Oh,
mercy. Holy is your only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and holy is your life-giving Spirit. You are holy and the giver of all that is good. For our salvation, your only begotten Son became flesh of the pure Virgin Mary, and by his divine plan he saved and redeemed us. Kyrie eleison.
Descending may make this bread.
the body of Christ our God.
So that none of your faithful may perish. Rather, make us worthy to live by your Spirit and lead a pure life. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
We offer you, O Lord, this divine sacrifice for your church, especially for our and shepherds, Francis the Pope of Rome, Shaula Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Shaula Peter, our retired Patriarch, Gregory John, our Bishop, and all the bishops of the true faith. With blameless lives and with purity and holiness, may they guide your church and present you a faithful people who honor your name. We pray to you, Lord.
Remember, O Lord, your people here before you, especially those who have presented these offerings. Forgive them so that they may always live blameless lives in your presence and recognize the blessings that you bestow upon them. For you are good and rich in graces, we pray to you, Lord. They may stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, to pacify the wounded communities and strife among the people, especially those in Texas. Shed your compassion and grace upon them all, so that your light and guidance may bring them to overcome ignorance and hatred. May your divine charity bring them all into the fullness of your kingdom. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all who have pleased you from the beginning, especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen, the Archdeacon, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Charlotte. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured suffering for the sake of your church and your people. May we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Thank you.
your servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. Do not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake. And receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries of purity and holiness. That through them we may be forgiven and made holy, and we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters,
and in your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One holy Father,
one holy Son, one holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy mind, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for our life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever. Beautiful, for spacious eyes, for
We thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name, and that of your only Son, and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And your
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself you saved us. Deliver us from damnation, and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.